ladies and gentlemen.
I'm very grateful to the organizers that I have the opportunity to present this technical presentation here, which is from Pyrexar Corporation and its hyperthermia technology. The title is Hyperthermia and MRI Tomography, Current Status and Future Directions. We are now in 2015, and MRI tomography was conceived and entered the field of hyperthermia in 2001 at Charité University Hospital in Berlin. Why was it created? Well, there's always a rationale, and this rationale for creating it has been extensively discussed here, and it is pretty simple. Any clinical modality which is used extensively or experimentally needs to be monitored. And it appears that the one single most important parameter for hyperthermia is monitoring of the temperature. There may be other parameters which are important, like SAR, but temperature is paramount, and temperature measurement so far has been invasive in multiple modes and with some impairments and possible limitations. So this is the agenda of this presentation, which is really about hyperthermia technology, a brief excursion towards principles, radiative versus capacitive technology, and then the two basic systems which have been around now for almost 20 years, which is the BSD2000 in its basic concept, and more sophisticated 3D, we come to that. Modes of temperature monitoring, and then MR-guided hyperthermia with MR temperature monitoring. And as this is has become, so to say, a product over these last 15 years of the new millennium, we have developed a software package which we call Sigma Vision, which has a certain ease of use, and we come to that. Regional hyperthermia, capacitive systems and radiative systems. How do they distinguish themselves? Capacitive systems use a frequency range which is around 13 megahertz, versus radiative systems which use the entire range from 70 to 1000 megahertz. The main difference doesn't want to work here. Yeah, now it comes. Now you see here the capacitive mode. Capacitive mode is that the patient is placed between two electrodes, and the electrons from one plate to the other plate through the patient take the most easy path they can take. And in this particular case, which you can see here, they go straight top down, which leads to an equal, seemingly equal heating of the entire patient cross-section with no focusing possibility. Instead, if you look at the radiative mode, which has this totally different frequency range, you have eight antennas which surround the patient. And from these antennas, which are called also a phased array, microwaves are emitted and focused on the centrum inside the body cross-section here, shown schematically. And this body cross-section can be adopted, and the tumor can be focused wherever it is inside this body. Another presentation of the same capacitive left, and more nicely configured capacitive presentation, right? You see the antennas here and the body trunk inside the applicator. And this is the electrical field directions. This is the BSD 2000 system family. You may, superficially looking at it, claim that they are pretty much the same. And in the handling, that is true. They are similar handling. This is the basic applicator with 8 antennas, which is powered with 4 amplifiers. On the lower right, you can see what we call the 3D system, which is equipped with 3 antenna rings, 24 antennas, and then this same system may be integrated into an MR system shown at the lower left. And we come again to the functional principles. 4 antenna pairs powered by 4 microwave amplifiers. Operational frequency range in this amplifier, which has a diameter of 60 centimeters. Operational frequency range is 70 to 120 megahertz. And the power which is possible to apply through this applicator into the patient is up to 2000 watts. Similar configurations of the same. And now we come to the 3D applicator, which is equipped, as you may see at the lower right, with 3 antenna rings. Why 3 antenna rings? It is for the purpose to be able to focus three-dimensionally the energy inside the patient onto the tumor. This was shown before in the first presentation by Rainer Inmüller. Left we see the central focus. Right, we see the right focus, and in the middle right focus, and to the right is the top focus. This is just to show how the focus works through variation of phase and amplitude of all 12 channels. This is a schematic view of the installation. You have 3 rooms. One room is a control room, which is here. And then you have the technical room, which is added here, more or less a couple of square meters to locate the amplifiers. And then you have the shielded room, which is here, which is a Faraday cage. Faraday cage is essential because the frequency range this is operated in, around 100 megahertz, is the exact frequency range of television and radio. We're coming to temperature monitoring, and as said before, the standard monitoring mode of temperature is invasive, transcutaneously intratumoral, which is that you have a catheter which is placed transcutaneously inside the tumor, and inside this catheter you have a thermistor which you can place there and which you can vary so you can see more than one temperature point. This mere explanation shows you drastically how limited such a mode is, because you cannot get more than a handful of temperature points within one catheter. Then we have the minimal invasive thermometry, which is described best by using the body orifices for thermoprobe placement. So you place again a catheter inside the rectum, the vagina, and the bladder. And thus you obtain point-wise temperature pattern, and which is good, so you know what you're doing. As pointed out earlier, it is paramount that temperature control and temperature monitoring is executed. The most sensitive of these temperatures is normally used for steering the heating of the tumor. Out of this, since the early outcome of magnetic resonance imaging, there has been the idea, why not monitor temperature through magnetic resonance imaging? Why MR, not computerized tomography? Well, MR has the peculiar and outstanding specificity of soft tissue discrimination, which is of key importance, of course, for any tumor treatment. So the early tentative trials were discussions with Hitachi, because this was still in the last century, in 95, because the first impression was that patient claustrophobia would limit placement of the patient inside a typical magnet tunnel, 1.5 or 3 Tesla. So open systems were those which were approached first, and these open systems at the time were best manufactured by our Japanese friends, mostly Hitachi, and those discussions went where they went. And at the end, it has been Munich University Hospital which decided for a combination with a 0.2 Tesla system, also an open system, which was installed in 97 and has been operated ever since. It was slow because the better thing is the enemy of the standard thing. So the better thing was then the immediately upcoming 1.5 Tesla system. And that was then chosen by Charité University Hospital as the first standard high field hybrid MRI hyperthermia system. This is an image of such a system. This system is installed at Erlangen University Hospital, and it shows nicely how the system operates. We have a patient support system which is added on to the system at the rear side of the magnet in that case, and where the patient is placed inside the hypothermia applicator, and then the entire system, patient support including the applicator, is shifted inside the magnet for patient treatment. This is a similar presentation from another perspective. This is, has been graciously made available by Peter Wust from Charité University Hospital, who deserves really all the merits framed by the special research grant from the German Federal Research Council for having developed this prototype system, which then is ever since has been manufactured by us under license. You see well the standard components of the MR system, which is the gradient coil and the shim coils. And you can well see how the applicator fits nicely inside the magnet tunnel. And it is of particular importance that the isocenter of the magnet tunnel and of the applicator are the same. This at the time was fairly easy to obtain. How can it be? Because the magnet diameter was 60 centimeters and our applicator barely could fit inside the 60 centimeter tunnel. So by essential mechanical engineering necessity, this device fitted nicely in the IC center of the system. As you may easily imagine, the typical site of installation, of such a system is the radiotherapy department. And radiotherapy departments tend to be totally independent since 20 years from diagnostic radiology. And diagnostic radiology, of course, is the monopolistic user of all MRI systems. This needs to be mentioned because without an in-depth consensus between diagnostic radiology and radiotherapy, such a project cannot see the light of the day in an institution. We, as a manufacturer, have not much to say here. So we had to adapt to the systems of choice of our customers. So what you see here is the first adaptation to General Electric system, as it has been installed at Erasmus University in Rotterdam. The institution where Dr. van der Zee is coming from, who has been presenting the clinical results of the institution. Bloop. This is again a treatment suit, as you may see typically, and as we have used it so far. The shielded room, which is not much different from any MRI room, and then the operator room and the technical room. And in these early systems, as we had them, you had the treatment side on this side of the magnet and the diagnostic side on the other side. As you have seen before, our new devices, as this adaptation with General Electric, is conceived in a different way, that both diagnostic and therapeutic use are arranged on a dockable cart, it's called, nice American word. And so you have one dockable cart for therapeutic use, hyperthermia use, and another one for diagnostic use. You can look at this video now and you will see what is our new approach. The new approach is different and we try to get away from doing special adaptation for every manufacturer. You have the applicator which can be opened and then is positioned inside the magnet. And then this is the same adaptation for General Electric or Philips or Siemens. And we may even decide to make Pyrex our OEM out of it. This is again the wiring scheme which you have seen this morning, so we skip this. Applicators. As it to be compatible with MRI imaging, our applicators need a special concept, a special design, so it must be manufactured exclusively for materials which are compatible with high field magnets. Thus, from left to right, you can see here the standard Sigma I applicator. It's called Sigma I because it has the shape of a human eye. 24 antennas arranged in three rings, powered in 12 channels, and the physical dimensions. Sigma 40 applicator, 40 because it has a diameter of 40 centimeters. Two antenna rings with 16 antennas, and the dimensions. It is to be said that the Sigma 40 applicator is almost exclusively used for pediatric applications, and the most prominent hyperthermia user for pediatric oncology and for treatment of children, mainly aimed at sarcoma treatment, at germ cell tumors, is the Department of Pediatric Oncology at the University Hospital of Düsseldorf, and they have such a hybrid system in addition to a standard system. And then the Sigma 30MR, which is a 30 centimeter diameter with 8 antennas and the physical dimensions, apt to lower extremity treatment of soft tissue sarcomas typically, and again aimed, as you might remember from this morning's presentation, at pediatric treatments. Children down to the age of 18 months have been treated for abdominal tumors in such an applicator. A little excursion into MR thermometry measurement, presenting the software package we have developed for this purpose. The calibration is done with four, we call it fat compensation tubes, 1, 2, 3, 4. We need these tubes for frequency shift compensation. And this is then the three-dimensional presentation of the tumor. So you have the coronal view, sagittal view, and axial view. Then you need to identify and do some segmentation in order to tell the system where the tumor is placed. So you do the outline of the tumor. This is done now. And after that, as you may have seen, we have a color overlay to display the temperature changes. As explained this morning, MRI temperature is done by subtraction of what we call phase images and physiological images, both done with typical PRFS pulse sequences, proton resonance frequency sequences. We have a timeline to monitor the chronological sequence of the treatment. It may be reminded here that the treatment lasts on temperature for 60 minutes. Out of this, then this software computes the T-NITRO temperature calculation and the timeline for each step. We go through this fast now. You see left down here the time, and we look at the timeline. Now it starts. Yeah, so I mean, it shows nicely and documents it, and this is then afterwards a part of the patient file. As the last major argument, I want to talk a little bit about hyperthermia treatment planning. Hyperthermia treatment planning has different bases than standard radiation treatment planning, as it cannot be otherwise. We have to segment the patient cross sections, which we obtain either by CT or MR, according to electrical conductivity. And the values of electrical conductivity are available from research in the literature. And so what I'm showing here is work in progress. It is not obvious to do an automatic segmentation for this, where all of the specific organs inside a patient cross section can be automatically identified by the software. There's still part of handwork to be done here. The external cross section and the bone contours are easily identified, but some soft tissue much less. You still do it by hand. What does this mean? Why I'm mentioning this? It means that today is today. Standard treatment planning for hypothermia may take in excess of 1 hour, because this is real work which has to be done, because you need to execute these segmentations on an entire stack, up to 25 or more slices of the patient. You go on from here. Now this is an example just to show you of a hypothermia treatment plan for a prostate cancer case. The computation grid tends so far is made is a triangular grid, and this triangular grid has been modified so no handwork is possible any is needed at the airport anymore. You can see the temperature ranges as they are indicated here, 41, 42, and 43. And then in the last slide, you see the optimized treatment plan for the prostate. And this is with the wire grids. This is the end of my presentation, which was rather incomplete, but time is limited. And also, I wanted to avoid redundancies with the other speakers. And I was particularly impressed by Professor Datta's presentation, which really deserves all the compliments. Thank you very much.